Thank you very much, Stefano, for the invitation and to take me here this time. It's a beautiful place and a great conference. So thank you very much, Stefano. And the other organizers also, of course. So let me start with the subject of my talk. Before the subject of my talk, let me just tell you that this is joint work with Aaron Brown, who is from Chicago University, and with Shirin Wang, who is in Penn State. Okay, so now once this is settled, so we are trying to study actions of groups larger than the integers or the real line, indeed much, much larger than these groups. And the way we started on thinking on this particular project was trying to understand when such an action has an invariant measure. Okay, so groups for this matter could be separated in two giant classes. One are the amenable groups, where the examples are finite groups, compact groups, abelian groups, nilpotent groups, solvable groups, and not much more, but something more. And the other class, which are the non-amenable ones, which is a much larger class. So when you have a group acting on an amenable group acting on a compact metric space, essentially by definition, you have an invariant measure always. For other groups, it's really a mystery. So let me start with an example of an action not having an invariant measure, which is very much to the point in our case. So example is quite simple. So let's say take SL to Z, so it's integer 2 by 2 integer matrices, or any other subgroup of SL to R will do, essentially. Well, not any, but reasonably. And then make it act on, say, the projective line, so RP1, okay, which is the circle, but is not the circle, so it's the set of directions, okay? So then the action is you take a direction here, L, and you pick a matrix A here, and then you send this guy into A times L. So you have a direction, it's a linear map, so it will send the direction to the direction. So then it takes a point here to a point here. Then you can see that if you take, for instance, your favorite matrix, the 2-1-1-1 map, then it has a stable space and an unstable space. Okay, so this implies that for this particular guy, maybe let's do the picture here, you will have two guys, which I don't know where to draw them, but let's say here and here, U and ES, which are the stable and unstable lines for this matrix, and this will be fixed point for this action of the matrix A, and you will have that the dynamics goes from the south to the north. Okay, so every line you take, if it is not the stable line, you start iterating it by A, and it will go all the way to the unstable line. Okay, so just from this picture, you see that if such an action have an invariant measure, it has to be essentially a combination of these two atoms, because it has to be invariant by this matrix, and this is a Morse-Mayer system, which is just north-south pole map or south-north pole map, and these are the invariant measure. Now you pick another matrix. Now it's tough. Whatever other matrix. And which has also integer entries and assume, so this is for A. And essentially, the best thing would be just to conjugate by something which doesn't leave this. But again, anyway, so you will have some, the unstable for B here, the stable for B probably will be here, maybe other configurations, but let's say you have something like this. And then you will have, again, the same phenomena for the B matrix. So if the measure is invariant by A and it's also invariant by B, then it's impossible, because on one hand it should be supported on these two points, and on the other hand it should be supported on these two points, and that's impossible. Okay, so there you have an example of a non-amenable group, okay, and here you have an action without an invariant measure. Okay, and these are called the projective actions, just obviously because this is projective. Okay, same thing you can do instead of the RP1, you can take the circle and then you will have 4 points for these maps. And similar example you can do if you take, for instance, SL3C, you can make it act either on S2 or on RP2, same way, and you have exactly the same phenomenon. Okay? So, then, since it is not obvious at all why there should be an invariant measure there, we just start asking whether we can find invariant measures. Okay? And indeed, we were worried at the time we started with not this type of low-dimensional system. We were worried about anosov actions, and we eventually did something about anosov actions, but in the meantime, we discovered something about these more low-dimensional cases. So let me state the theorem we found. Let me state it in the simplest way. Okay, theorem. So everything is with my co-author, so it's... I will not put names there. So it says you take gamma, a lattice in SLNR, gamma a lattice. This means discrete and SLNR mod gamma co-compact, finite volume. It could be co-compact, of course. Then we'll have finite volume. And we can do for more general groups, but let me stick to SLNR. It's, everything is simpler to state. Assume gamma acts, let's just put this way, in diffeomorphisms of M, infinity. Less differentiability is good enough, but then I will need to discuss differentiability, so I don't want, so let's go to infinity. C1 would not be enough for several stuff. So let's say dimension of M equals 2D, then 1, if D is less than or equal n minus 2, then, I should call it alpha. Alpha has an invariant measure. And the second part says that in the case D is equal to n minus 1, then of course I cannot say 1 because I have this example here. I have SL3 acting on a two-dimensional manifold without an invariant measure. So certainly I cannot say that you will have always an invariant measure, but we can say that and alpha has no invariant measure, then alpha is smoothly conjugated to the projective action on Sn minus 1 or Rpn minus 1. And of course, to say that, I need to say something here, which is M connected, because if it is not connected, you will have whatever combinations of this. Okay, so that's what we found. So the only abstraction for in those low-dimensional settings to have the invariant measure is exactly this example. Yes? Compact. Indeed, if it is not compact, you can put some integrability conditions on the action and you will still get one. For two, we didn't check. So we cover the manifold with charts, and we use compactness in two, essentially, yes. Maybe something can be done, but... Okay, so this is essentially the main result I want to discuss. I guess I will stick to this result, okay? Let me see if I have to say something more about this. The corollary. Okay. So corollary, when you go back to d equals to 2, and indeed, whatever I'm saying for d equals to 2 should be exactly the same true for larger d, and this will explain a lot the first part, but we were not able to do anything in this case. So assume gamma is SL and Z. So now is you want this particular lattice. Then either 1 gamma factors through a finite action. So it means that you have that the kernel of this alpha is a finite index. So it's really you are not acting by this S, L, and Z. You are acting by something finite, and then you are just having this map. Or 2 is the same as the 2 there. So gamma or n equals to 3 and m is either S2 or RP2. And alpha is smoothly conjugated. M?
N equals to 2
is 0? Never. Yes, thanks. Too perceptive. Yeah, also here, probably here it follows from the way it's written, but let me just. Maybe not. Yeah, I want n larger equal to 3. So I well, probably here, yeah, here for n equals to 2 is certainly not is a mess, even if it's the circle. So I wouldn't try to prove anything like that yet. And for, of course, 1 for n equals to 2 is fine. Okay. So and the corollary, indeed, let me just comment the proof. So the main thing is that Franks and Handel, so John Franks and Handel, prove that if there exists an invariant measure, then the action is trivial. So, well, trivial in this sense. Action is like 1. So once you have the invariant measure, the action has to factor through a finite group, okay? So what we did is we prove that there is always the invariant measure, and then you can use Franks Handel, okay? And the second is completely followed from this first, so. And in that's why, so that's why we need here the lattice. So you need, to apply Franks and Handel, you need this unipotent element, so this type of matrices. Say something like that, so which are distortion elements for the lattice, and then they play a lot with these rotation numbers and all this stuff, entropies, and but you need this element. So if the lattice were co-compact, then what they do doesn't work. Maybe there is some modification. We didn't try that, but certainly will not be quite simple. So, but anyway, anyone who is willing can try, of course. Okay, so this is the main theorem and the corollary. So let me start discussing a little bit about the proof of the theorem and the construction behind it. Okay, there will be a lot of ergodic theory here. There are invariant measures, so we should expect ergodic theory. And there will be smooth ergodic theory, passing theory, and all this stuff. Okay, so the whole goal here is you look hard to get your invariant measure, okay? So you go all the time to find your invariant measure. And at some point, you will fail. And at the time you fail, you will get a lot of information from the failure. And then you win. You have to work to win, but still, you win. So... So for that, we need some starting point. So we need to start with some invariant measure, invariant by someone, okay? And then you promote this invariant by someone to more invariants and more invariants and more invariants. But you need to start with something. So let me tell you what is this something. So for the ones that came to Jens Markloff course, you will know. If not, you can guess probably from linear algebra that you can decompose this as KAN, where this is compact, this is the diagonal, and these are the nilpotent, and this you call P. So here, K is essentially, I never remember if it is SO or O, but doesn't matter, I guess. A is diagonal. I guess I should put determinant, so the sum minus one somewhere, so let me put this there. And A is e to the t1, e to the tn, where the sum of the ti is 0, and n is 1's in the diagonal, 0's here, and whatever you want up here. So the p is just whatever you want diagonal, whatever you want upper diagonal, 0's below. And the first news is that p is solvable, hence amenable. Which means that whenever P acts on a space, on a nice space, if it is compact metric, then you are happy. But if it is not compact metric, still a nice space will do with a nice action, then you will have an invariant measure. So we have to make P act somewhere and get a P invariant measure from there. Okay, so how to do that? You do the same thing when you have one diffeomorphism, so you do a suspension construction. Okay, so what is the suspension? So you have your manifold M, you have your group G, let me just write G for SLNR, it's shorter. You have your gamma acting on your M. So if gamma were the integers, then G would be the real numbers, and if you have an iteration of F, you can take the suspension and you can build a suspension flow. So here we are doing the same, and instead of having the integers and the real numbers, we are doing the lattice gamma and the group G. And we will have exactly the same picture. So you do G times M, and you quotient by some relation. Okay, so what is the relation? The relation says that you take a point gx and you relate here with g gamma alpha gamma inverse of x. So that's what you do. Okay, so you make this identification. So how this business look like? So this space that we call it m alpha. So this m alpha will fiber over the G mod gamma, which is this space. You will have the G acting here naturally by left multiplication, and you will have here also the G acting here also by left multiplication on the first factor. So if you take A star, the class of GX, you just send it into AGX. So you are not doing anything in the second factor, at least not upstairs, but then the quotient, so the identification, is telling you that you are doing something. So it's the same thing as suspension flow. So, and then if you draw something like that, so this is the G, maybe I will not have space here, let's do it here. So here is the G mod gamma. Then over each point of the G mod gamma, you will have, say, one of your manifolds M, and that's how this M alpha looks like. So for every point here, you have that. So you flow here like the G mod gamma, G acting on G mod gamma is telling you. You flow here down, and then upstairs you're essentially doing nothing. But when you make a loop, essentially, you start doing something. So you can take fundamental domains and see it more more detailed. Okay, then we have a nice space. So if gamma is co-compact, then this is a compact metric space. If gamma is not co-compact, then it's not a compact metric space, like in the picture. You have here a cusp, but still the fiber is compact and uniformly compact, and you can use amenability of P, since G is acting, then P is acting, and then you just pick at P invariant measure. So, pick a p-invariant measure, mu, a p-invariant measure for alpha projecting to hard measure on G mod gamma. Okay, so we have this projection P here. So we have the alpha action acting here. You have the natural action here, which is essentially a joint action acting here. And you have this, too many P's, let's call it pi. So the pi projection here. And since if you take the measure here and it's invariant by P, then it will project to some measure which is invariant by P here. And the only P invariant measure here is hard measure, so it will be automatically hard. But you just have this guy. Okay, this is the invariant measure, whenever you have the invariant measure. Okay, so we are going to try to prove that this measure is invariant. Capital P is this group. Yes. Yes, yes, yes. Is. All this. Thanks. So, good. So, how to prove that this measure is invariant? Well, you first define a group, Q sub mu, which is all the elements G in G, such that alpha of G star mu equals to mu. So, all the elements of the group that leaves this measure invariant. And I'm denoting here also by alpha the action on this suspension, so I don't want to put tildes or this type. So, so you take this group. This is a closed group because being leaving measure invariant is something continuous, so it's a closed subgroup of G. Let's not speak about connectedness. So, and it certainly contains the P. Okay, so these type of groups are called essentially parabolic groups. So, okay, so now to just to be able to draw pictures, let me assume that n equals to 3, dimension is 2. Okay, so let me just show you what's going on with there. So here is P. And I know that my measure is invariant by all these flows. So when you put a number in any of these positions and then a 0 or a 1 according to what it must be, then you have a one-parameter flow there. And you have invariance along all these guys. So if you want to gain full invariance, then you need to gain invariance along this, this, and this. So you want to prove that the measure is invariant by the flow generated by this element, and by this element. So essentially, you have these three flows, this flow, and then the similar flow when you put all there. Okay, and you want to prove that the measure is invariant by these guys. Okay, so this is because you have n equals to 3. Now comes the first non-trivial thing. So I need to introduce some terminology. So which is coarse Lyapunov exponents. Okay, so I have my p-invariant measure, so since the diagonal is inside the p in particular, this measure is diagonal invariant. And this diagonal group is, so let's still maintain here, so here A is essentially the same as R2. And I can take any element A in this A. I look at this action on this, so in this case is what? SL3, so it's 8 plus 2 is in this 10-dimensional manifold. So acting on the M alpha. And I can look at the Lyapunov exponents and the oscillated splitting of this action. Okay, so let me again draw this picture here. So I will have that the tangent to M alpha, I will not write down yet oscillated splitting. I will first write this splitting, which is I have a tangent to the orbit foliation by the shift foliation times the tangent to the fibers here. So I have this eight-dimensional space, and I have this two-dimensional space, and this is an invariant splitting for the action just by construction. Then oscillators will tell me that this piece decompose, and indeed for this I don't need oscillators, so it's, when I look at this part, I already know what does G acting on G himself, so I really know what's going on there, and these are the So the derivative of this, or the corresponding associated here spaces. So these are the invariant splitting for the oscillated theorem. So you put a non-zero here, non-zero here, 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 here. So you have these six spaces, and you have these six invariant spaces plus the two-dimensional coming from this R2. So you have here some of some guys which are called psi ij, which correspond to putting the ij's here, plus some of the, let's put the ta, so the tangent to the diagonal. So these do the, these eight guys, so these are beautiful. And then I have two other guys, which come from here, which is some e eta 1 plus e eta 2. Okay, I have all this decomposition. So for the G part, everything is known and understood. For the M part is oscillator's theorem that tells me that you have two Lyapunov exponents, they may coincide, so I have no idea. And this, you have this direct sum. Okay, but then let me do some more things. So there is an A here, so I pick this A and I applied oscillator's theorem to this A. So everything depends on A, of course. But since A is an abelian group, so guys, they are commute, so oscillator splitting, once it works for one element, as soon as this element is generic enough, then it will work for all the other elements. It's just the same reason why two commuting matrices are jointly diagonalizable. So it's the very same reason, it's uniqueness of bundles in oscillator splitting. So this part I already described is very well understood. And here you will have these bundles that do not depend on A, even though the exponent will depend on A. Okay, it's not the same to have the identity or having A or 2 times A. So you, it has to depend, and even worse. So let me now draw the picture of A. Here comes A. So A will have, first of all, these three guys, which is chi 1, 2, chi 1, 3, chi 3, 1, and the lines, 2, 3. And the lines means, so what I'm drawing is the kernel of these guys. So it turns out, again, it just follows easily from Oscillator's theorem, and it's linear algebra to see that when you invalidate your A, these Lyapunov exponents become linear functionals. So they have kernel. Of course, the kernel could be everything. But from this side, you know that the kernel are only real lines. So you have these kernels of these functionals here. Okay? So depending whether you pick the A here, then you have positive or negative. You pick them here, then the corresponding will be 0, and the other will be positive, negative, depending on the picture. And by some symplectricity property on these matrices, so on how the A acts here, you will have that the kernels will be the same. So the kernel of chi 2-3 is here, and you have that chi 2-3 is minus chi, I guess, 3-2, yeah? And similarly, so chi 1-3 is minus chi 3-1, and so on. So one is the opposite of the other. So the lines will be the same, even though you have different Lyapunov exponents. Okay, so this takes charge of this part. Now comes this other part. So I have the eta 1 and the eta 2. These are two new functionals. And it may happen, essentially, several things. So, but most importantly, where do you have color chalk? Here, yes. Good. I hope you see it. Anyway. So let's say here is, I see it white, but maybe you see it, the color it has to be. Anyway. So here you have the eta 1, and you will have some eta 2. And I'm drawing it in a sense that is good for me. So the eta 1 is not coinciding with one of these guys here. Okay, but they may coincide. So it may be that the eta 2, and this will be also one possibility, that the kernel of eta 2 is the same as one below. So let me make a definition now. Maybe two definitions. One, we call a Lyapunov exponent, Lyapunov exponent for a the G direction. Ooh, it's breaking. G direction, a root. This corresponds to the theory of Lie group, so these guys are roots of the Lie group, and these are the root space of the Lie group. And second is we say a root is non-resonant with respect to alpha if, let's just say, call it the root R. So R is one of these chi ij. If R is different, let's just write it with letter, is not a positive multiple of eta 1 and eta 2. So if this is not going on, so here, this root is a resonant root. So this guy is resonant. But this guy is non-resonant. Well, this guy, I'm sorry, is for the root. So this guy is non-resonant, this guy is non-resonant. Well, the point is, since roots come in pairs, so once you have positive, either one or the other will be bad. But it still is important. So you will see next theorem why some roots, even if they are resonant, you don't care. And some other roots, you really care whether they are resonant or not. So here comes the first main theorem. So, but let me just attach here. So attach to each of these roots, you have your group, which is this group, attached to this root space. And then we have the theorem, which is completely general. So it's just any dimension, any group, any whatever. So even rank one, but rank one is trivial statement. So if a root R is non-resonant, then mu, the p invariant measure mu, is gr invariant. So as soon as I have a non-resonant root, I win invariance along this direction. So if this Lyapunov exponent corresponding to this direction is non-resonant with whatever happened in the M in this torus picture there, then you get invariance by this group here, which means I complete this square here. And then I have to go to the next square. So in this picture of Lyapunov exponents I draw there, the bad guy is chi13. So chi13, if I understand it correctly, is here. So this is chi13. So I will win invariance by this direction and this direction. Okay? Then I know that Q mu will contain all matrices of this form, but Q mu is a group. So it will have to contain this direction also, because any group containing this, all these matrices, will contain everything. And then I want invariance at once. And that's essentially the trick when you go to higher dimensions. So when, not higher dimensions, so when then the n grows, even if the d is small. So I guess I have something like 5 minutes, so let me, instead of, so you can think of this theorem. Let me not go into proofs of this theorem. So this theorem is very much related with this Le Drapier invariance principle. And indeed, when we write the proof, we, in the meantime, prove some conditional Abramov-Rocklin formula. So it's a version of the standard Abramov-Rocklin formula. And we also prove some kind of splitting of entropy along these type of directions here. Okay, so, but let me not enter into this. So I prefer to move forward and show you how to get, say, the one and the two properties. Not here, I guess, so in the theorem. From what I wrote. Okay. Proof of theorem. So I did a number, so you should guess which theorem I'm proving, but this is the first one or the second one, okay, in this situation. So n equals to 3, d equals to 2. So you have this group Q mu. And as I told you, I have to add these guys. So then I look at chi13, chi12, and chi23. So I have these three roots to check whether they are proportional or not. Now, the news is that up to some reasonable isomorphism and up to what I really care, so the groups containing P are either the P himself or this guy, or this group, or there is a symmetric, which you put the star here instead of the star there, but these are essentially the same thing up to some rearrangement, or everything. Okay? So let's assume that the measure Q mu is not everything. So from everything. So if not, I got there my invariant measure by G, and once it is you have the invariant measure by G, you can make build your gamma invariant measure on the manifold, just some conditional measure construction. So I have these three root spaces and I have only two Lyapunov exponents on M. So one of the three should not be resonant. So I win one extra invariant. So if this extra invariant is the guy down here, then you will get again the whole group. So then the guy that is not resonant should be one of these two guys, and by some symmetric consideration, I just have this. So I can assume that Q mu is exactly that. Okay? So that is what is Q mu. Okay, so once I know that is Q mu, the next news is that when I do G mod Q mu, and while the gamma was quotient both to the right, the Q mu, you have to quotient it to the left to make it in the right way, you get that this is, whether you allow some positive or negative sign or not, but this is essentially RP2. Okay, so if you allow only positive entry up here, then it will be the S2. If not, it's the RP2. So there is the sphere you are looking for, or the RP2 you are looking for. So here is the model. So you want to prove that your M is equivalent to this quotient, and that your dynamics is the same as the gamma action here. So that's what comes next. I have 2 more minutes, so that's, let's say, let me just comment on what's going on here. So this type of suspension construction and this type of argument I was drawing here, and the most important is the proof that would start here, is essentially similar to the proof of Margulis normal subgroup theorem. So in Margulis normal subgroup theorem, he proved something similar to this type of statement. So he proved that if you have a phi from G mod P into M, where you have your gamma, your natural gamma action here, and your whatever gamma action here, some quasi-invariant measure, blah, 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 then this guy is measurably isomorphic to G mod this type of Q mu, okay? And in a very natural way. So what we do is we just, so we build the proof differently, so our choice of Q mu is not the same as him and all this technical subtlety, but at the end of the day, we just apply some measure rigidity type of statement, and you need to prove that when you take conditional measures along some Pessin manifolds, then these conditional measures, which will be a graph, will have to be smooth graphs. And once you have these smooth graphs are the conjugancy. So you win the conjugancy from the conditional measure. So that's how you build the conjugancy. So you think an invariant measure as a joining, and you think your mu as so you have this fiber bundle. You think of mu as a joining from your G mod gamma action here and your action on the M here. But then you have to twist your understanding, so your G mod gamma will become your G mod Q, and then your G mod Q will be the same as this guy here. So it is, I think I don't have too much time to discuss it later. Thank you very much.